Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
We are so thankful to be here. We welcome you to Sunday morning service here at Berea Church, where we believe in praising God.
Thank you, Lord.
Teaching and preaching the Word of God, and we're so thankful to be able to have an opportunity to do that. At this time, we are going to open up with prayer. We're going to have Bishop Abram come and open us up. So let's receive him at this time. Amen.
Amen.
Let us bow our heads. Father, we just want to thank you this day. We thank you for another day that you've given us. And we want to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. In the name of Jesus. And Lord, we just lift up our leaders, not only in this country, but in other countries. Over in the book of Timothy, it tells us to pray for kings and those in authority, that we might live a peaceable life. So we pray for our president, our vice president, the premiers and the presidents of other nations, that you would bless them and that they will seek you and allow you to direct them to lead their countries. Now, we thank you for freedom. We thank you for liberty, not only in this nation, but in those that are free. And Lord, we thank you that there is a liberty that's beyond the liberty that we have, and that's in you. And so we thank you for the liberty we have in Christ Jesus. Now, God, we pray for those that are hurting today, those who've lost loved ones, and those who are sick, those who are in hospitals, and those who will be having surgery. Take them through, Lord. Take them through. And Lord, we pray that you'd have your way in our services today, that we'll lift your name on high. We'll praise and magnify your name. We give you glory. We give you honor. And we'll give you the praise. And also, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. In the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen. Praise God for that prayer. At this time, we're going to ask Minister Darnetta if she would come with the scripture. Let's receive her by saying amen.
Amen.
Amen. Scripture said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. This is the day the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm going to read Psalms chapter 23. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Yes.
Amen. He is our Father. He's the one we need to be able to recognize his voice. Amen. Amen. I thank God for that. I remember one time I had this minor procedure, and you know, they'll have you heavily sedated when you're in pain. And I remember laying there, and I felt like I couldn't hardly even open up my eyes. And I remember hearing different voices in the background. I could hear the nurses, the doctors, the people coming in to check in on me. But when my father came in, I could hear his voice. And I opened up my eyes and I was able to recognize. But I praise God for that opportunity, you know, that we have a father that we can hear. We have a father that hears us. When we cry out, he's there. Even if it's in the middle of the night, he's there.
Amen.
Amen. It doesn't matter. God is good and he's faithful. I just appreciate the Lord for all he's done, all he's doing. There's been a song on my heart. I know Christmas was yesterday. You know, we celebrated. Amen. But I just want you to sing just a little bit with me of this song. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. For he alone is worthy, for he alone is worthy, for he alone is worthy, Christ the Lord. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord, we bless your name. You're worthy to be praised, God. There is none like you in all the earth. Hallelujah. We bless you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's a good God. He's a merciful Savior. We needed a Savior because we were lost. Hallelujah. And I thank him. I thank him. At this time, I'm going to call on our pastor, Pastor John Lee. Let's receive him by saying amen. 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 Hallelujah.
Amen, church. Amen. Amen again. Put your hands together. Come on, Brother Anthony in the back. We thank the Lord for just another day's journey. And thank him for a wonderful holiday season. Thank you for each and every one of you. And at this time, as always, we want you to just get up and go shake someone's hand. Tell them you love them. And no one is exempt. Give somebody a fist bump or whatever you feel comfortable with. Tell them you love them this morning.
Good morning, Jesus. All right. So glad you're here. Good morning, Jesus. You're welcome here. Oh, there goes my burden. There goes my fears. Good morning, Jesus. So glad you're here. Good morning, neighbor. So glad you're here. Good morning, neighbor. You're welcome here. So lay down your burdens. Lay down your fears. God bless you. Good morning, neighbor. So glad you're here. Oh, good morning, Jesus. So glad you're here. Good morning, Jesus. You're welcome here. Oh, there goes my burdens. There goes my fears. Good morning, Jesus. So glad you're here. Come on, sing it with me. Good morning, Jesus. So glad you're here. Good morning, Jesus. You're welcome here. Oh, there goes my burdens. There goes my fears. Good morning, Jesus. So glad you're here. Oh, I'm so glad you're here. So glad I'm here. Come on. So glad I'm here. I'm here in Jesus' name. Come on, sing it. I'm so glad I'm here. Come on, sing it. So glad. Are you glad to be in the service? I'm here in Jesus' name. Sing it. Oh, I'm so glad I'm here. I'm so glad I'm here. Yeah. So glad I'm here. I'm here in Jesus' name. Come on, sing it. I'm so glad I'm here. I'm so glad I'm here. Yes, I'm so glad I'm here. I'm here in Jesus' name. Now listen, this song didn't used to mean that much to me, I'm going to be honest, before. But when you go through a pandemic and quarantine, and you know folks have gotten COVID and sick and other diseases, not just COVID, but at the end of 2021, the Lord spared my life, allowed us to all still be here. How many are really, truly just glad to still be here in Jesus' name? Come on, sing it like you mean it. Oh, I'm so glad I'm here. Yes, so glad I'm here. Oh, I'm so glad I'm here. I'm here in Jesus' name. One more time. I'm so glad I'm here. Yes, I'm so glad I'm here. I'm so glad I'm here. I'm here in Jesus' name. Oh, this is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. Sing it. I will rejoice. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. Come on, one more time. This is the day. This is the day. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. I will. It's a declaration today. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. Oh, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. I was glad. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, let us go into the house of the Lord. One more time, I was glad. I was glad when they said unto me. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me. Yes, I was glad. When they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. My father used to sing this. Oh, victory is mine. Oh, victory is mine. Victory today is mine. Sometimes you gotta speak to that mountain. I told Satan, get thee behind. Cause victory today. Sing, joy is mine, joy is mine. Oh, joy is mine, joy today is mine. I told Satan, get thee. Yeah, cause joy today is mine. Peace is mine, oh, peace is mine. One more time, victory. Victory is mine. Oh, victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee. Cause victory today is mine. Come on, shout it to God with a voice of triumph. If you know that victory is yours. If you know that victory is yours, Dr. Tony Evans said, we don't even fight for victory, we fight from victory. Yeah.
We already have victory. We already are declared victors in Christ, and I'm so glad about it. We don't have to muster up strength and think, oh, what do we need, and where are our weapons, and what can we use to fight against the enemy? No, it says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not even things that we can pick up and start to fight, Bishop. We have to just stay in a spirit of prayer, a spirit of peace, declaring victory every day, even when we don't feel like it. Sometimes we just have to keep saying, God, you are my peace, and peace is unto me. And I declare it, and I speak joy. I speak life. I speak peace and happiness in my home and in my job and at school and with my parents and with my friendships and relationships. That's you today. Just begin to just meditate just for a few minutes. I just ask you to concentrate on the Lord. Draw your mind in, and whatever you came in here with. We were listening to something on the way here, and it said that the wise men said, and they found another way to go home. Sometimes when the enemy puts up a roadblock, don't even fret. Just find a different way. Find a different way to get to where God wants you to get to. Don't even give energy. Don't even give any kind of credit to what's going on. And just say, it's all right. There's always another way. And God always has the final say. Hallelujah. I said, God always has the final say. Come on, just speak that even to yourself. I know God has the final say. Whatever's going on in my life, whatever I face, whatever the enemy tries to throw at me, God still has the final say. Love it. First Lady Lynetta just started lifting that up. Oh, come, let us adore him. That's what the psalmist David said. Come, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast of the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. And there it is. He says, oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. And some people stop there, but I actually like that next verse. It said, I sought the Lord. I sought the Lord and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. Not just some of them, all of them. Took care of me. Has he taken care of you in 2021? Kept your mind at peace. Come on, a few more moments. Just meditate on his goodness and his mercy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
You are good.
Because all my life, you have been faithful. Thank you, Jesus. And all my life, you have been so, so good. And with every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. You can change the key. Go ahead, go down. Hallelujah. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. That's all it is. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. That's all it is. Say, all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able. With every breath that I am able. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yeah, one more time. All my life, think about this year and tell them. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Now, I want you to think about that one thing this year. And I know there were probably many, but think about the one thing you really wanted God to do for you, or you thought he was going to come through on, and things turned out a little different than you thought. At that moment, you might have thought it was disappointment. But when you sing and hear these lyrics, just remember it was God's protection. It was him redirecting you. Because his goodness runs after us, chases us down until we understand that it's good and it wasn't meant for evil. I felt that. Chases us down until we change our interpretation and our understanding of what goodness is. Because what we think is good is not good. Someone said, if you and God are agreeing all the time, then that means you're not worshiping God. Yeah. Because all my life you have been faithful. He was protecting me. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Because your goodness is running after me. Because your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Come on, sing it, because your goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Because your goodness, because your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Aren't you glad about it? Because your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Tell them, say your goodness, because your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, Lord, your goodness, because your goodness is running after, it's running after me. One more time, say your goodness, because your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Tell them, say your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything, Lord, because your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Because all my life, you have been faithful. Yeah, tell them. And all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Sing, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. Just your voice all my life. And all my life you have been faithful. Sing it out. Sing all my life. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able. I will sing of the goodness of God. 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 All right, Pastor John, come on back up. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank God, that was a wonderful worship song and songs. Thank God for his presence this morning. What a blessing to be in the presence of God. We're just thankful that you are here for fellowship this morning, and thankful for my sister coming to minister. I called her last night, so she's always ready, in season and out of season, and we appreciate that in the child of God. That is a command from the Bible, to be ready. So I'm thankful for all those who are ready to go when God needs something, you know, whether it be to feed someone or to call someone, to pray for someone, to come and lead worship, to come and teach and preach. Bible says, be ready in every season, and don't let a particular season in your life stop you from being ready. That's one thing I like about David. David was ready, wasn't he? He had needed a rock or a sword or just a song of praise. He was ready, wasn't he? He was ready for every season, and that is a good way to be. Just grateful this season for all God has done, and just the attitude of gratitude that we continue to have. Joy and peace, she mentioned. Those great things that stem from faith. You know, those are the things that matriculate down from faith. A lot of times we tell people we have faith, but our faith is to settle into joy and peace. The Bible says being justified by faith, we have peace with God. And once you have peace, then there ain't no reason not to be happy.
That's right.
Don't let the enemy drive that joy from you. He's a thief of joy. And for any old reason, he'll take your joy. He'll take your joy because there's granulated sugar and not sweetener in the cupboard and have you fussing and being mad. But don't let sweetener stop you from giving God praise. Can I get amen? They're fighting across the country over gifts of department stores and carrying on and letting the enemy take their joy. I remember the Cabbage Patch Dolls. How many want to age yourself a little bit? Boy, they acted crazy about them dolls, didn't they? Them dolls looked as crazy as anything you ever seen, didn't they? But I'll tell you what, about Christmas time, they sure showed out, didn't they? We're not going to let the enemy take our joy this morning. Some people don't want you to be happy, Pastor.
Right.
Out of all the things that they would want to steal from you, they want to take my joy. You can't take that my joy. You know, I have a brother, and he's always smiling. And in funerals or weddings, it don't matter. He's smiling. Sometimes, well, why is he smiling? He's smiling. And somebody just passed away. But it's inherent in him. He's always been that way. It's not a mistake. It's a God has put it into him. I don't know if it's a mechanism or what, but I know you can't steal his joy. And if you're a joy thief, he'll probably drop you off at the village pantry or something. But, you know, we thank God for you all who have not lost your joy. I know it's a little warm in here. I don't want you to lose your joy because it's hot. Bishop, could you take it down just a notch? We don't want the heat. Don't let the heat take your joy. Amen. I told my cousin, he married a lady. He's a pastor in Indianapolis. Henry, we're going to have him down soon. Henry McMullen, and he married a young lady named Joy, and I sort of just observed them, and I told him, I said, Henry, whatever happens, don't let nobody steal your joy, either one of them. And that was a prophetic word, and because the enemy is against marriage, and he'll use anybody he can to break up a good marriage, won't he? Anybody and the closest folks to you be the ones ready to break it up. But I told him, don't let nobody steal your joy. Don't let them steal her, and don't let them steal that deep happiness that we have. Amen. Two or three times a day, I find something to laugh about, purposely laugh about. And sometimes it's people that just got to get my joy out. But that's something God has commanded joy in the life of a believer. It is the fruit of the Spirit, the natural production of being in relationship with God and being close to Him is joy. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. These are the natural byproducts of a relationship with God. I heard years ago a lesson taught about the forgotten fruit, which he says was long-suffering. And it's even during this time where we are so quick to not be patient with people. You know, but I believe it is a bit of a lost fruit because it sort of gets pushed down on the table. But I can't truly love you if I'm not patient with you. And we have a tendency to be patient with ourselves and not to one another. So don't let anybody steal that wonderful fruit God has given you. Without further ado, I want to just talk to about my brother-in-law here, my brother. I don't really call him my brother-in-law. It's not a term I use. The laws in general, I don't really use them because I'm pretty close to everyone. But my brother, Jim Terry, from New York, Hempstead, New York, is that correct? He is from Hempstead, New York, and he has then came into my sister's life at the tender age of 24 years old. He had his eyes on her at 23. But they went to Anderson together and received their degrees there in Anderson. And it's just funny, sort of the hapchance of God of putting people together. He's from New York, she's from the big city of Crawfordsville, population 12,000. But he brought them together for the work of the ministry. And God always brings two people together for the work of the ministry and for his glory. So if you're looking for somebody, you want to look for somebody that's going to work with you in ministry. Amen. But he is a perfect man. And there's a few definitions of perfect in the Bible. One of them is blameless, and the Bible says Jesus was blameless. And then there's men like Job, and I think the Bible lists three men in antiquity, Noah, Daniel, and Job, who God said he may have saved the world for, just speaking to their goodness and righteousness. But Jim is a perfect man, and I say that because I can. You can't declare you're perfect. You can't declare that you are mature and excellent, but someone else has to do it. The Bible says let praise come from another man's lips and not your own. So when we look down through the body of work over the last two decades that I've known him, he's been a great brother. He hasn't led me astray. Even in ministry, people lead you the wrong way by their behavior. Jim has not led me the wrong way. And a lot of times the people who you think are watching ain't paying no attention to you. And the people who seem to not pay you a lot of attention are giving you a lot of attention, picking up those crumbs that fall from the table of someone who has mastered something good. And we've had some great preachers here, haven't we? Bishop Wittenberg just came and rocked the house, and we've had some men over the years shake the walls of this place, and I beat on the podium if I don't do nothing else. But it's nice when we have a great character. Great character. The best message preached is life well lived. And he's treated my sister very well. And that's good when you're spoiled like Mrs. She's not spoiled. He has. He's treated her very well. And he's a good model for ministry and being a husband. Because those things go hand in hand. Yes, they do. Jim, we love you. We are excited about hearing the word for you. Somebody in the old style say, preach the word.
Preach the word.
Oh, say it louder than that. Say, preach the word.
Preach the word.
Preach the word. Let's stand. Let's give him a hand clap this morning. Come on, let's stand and give him a hand praise. God's name with God's word. Amen. Thank you. Appreciate you too.
My response is
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
My response.
My response is hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
One more time, you have rescued.
You have rescued my life.
You have
rescued my life. And I'm never going back.
You
have rescued my life.
Else
you.
You
have rescued my life,
and I'm never
going back.
Father, we just thank you, we bless you. Thank you, God, for being here with us, and we thank you, Lord, even as on the cusp, on the heels of celebrating your birth. God, we know you are the Ancient of Days, so yesterday just marked the moment of the plan of this great plan of salvation. We know, God, you existed before time. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was God. The Word was with God. Lord, we thank you that without you, there's nothing that was made. But God, we thank you that we celebrate not only your birth, God. We thank you, Lord, we are moving into a new realm, God. Even in the last few days of this year, we believe that you are so great. You are so merciful that even in the last few days, if there's a promise you have to fulfill, you'll meet that promise, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We can hold on to your promises today. We can hold on to what you promised us, and we thank you for meeting us here in this place, meeting us in worship. God, now meet us in the Word. God, we thank you for Pastor, Lord. We thank you for First Lady. We bless you for their lives. God, we thank you, God, again, for all you have done, God. We bless you, God, for Pastor Meredith, Lord Abrams, Lord. We thank you, God, for how you always work things out for our good. God, we thank you for today. We know there are no accidents in the kingdom. And so, God, even today, God, we believe a word is from you. God, we pray that you will be with us, meet us. God, show up, God, and do only what you can do. God, let your anointing fall afresh, and we give you praise, God. We bless you for our neighbor to our left and right, for those, God, who may witness this by way of social media. Lord, we pray that you will move through the airwaves. Yes. God, promote healing, God, deliverance and salvation. And we thank you now. We bless you, God, for it. And we believe that the best is yet to come in the name of Jesus. We declare it so in Jesus' name. If you believe God for that, why don't you give God praise in this place? Hallelujah. Because she's worthy, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank God again for the opportunity. I don't never take it lightly to be in anyone's pulpit or anyone's place and desk of sacredty. We thank God for, again, the opportunity to be here. Bless God for you, Pastor John, and for your wife, and God for the things that God wants to do. Thank God for my wife and for Joyce Ann Lee Terry, amen. 21 years, about to move into 22, so thank God. You know, sometimes it's hard for 22 minutes for some folks, so we just thank God. Amen, somebody. Y'all catch it later on. But we thank God again for the privilege to be here and to share. And I just believe that God is up to something always. And you just got to look out for God to move. So if you have your Bible, turn to John chapter 11, familiar passage of scripture, familiar story. And we're just going to do what the Lord says do on this word today. John chapter 11. And I'll start, we'll read just for part of the context. We're going to read chapter verse 1. Amen. I just want to look at another part. We're going to read verse 1 through 11, and then we'll skip down to 23 to 25. If you don't mind, just stand one time for the reading of God's word. You find it, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And it says, a man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. This is Mary, who later poured the expensive perfume on the Lord's feet and wiped them with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was sick. So the two sisters sent a message to Jesus telling him, "Lord, your dear friend is very sick." But when Jesus heard about it, he said, "Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this." So although Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next 2 days. Somebody say 2 days. Finally, he said to his disciples, "Let's go back to Judea." But his disciples objected. "Rabbi," they said, "only a few days ago, the people in Judea were trying to stone you. Are you going there again?" Jesus replied, "There are 12 hours of daylight every day. During the day, people can walk safely. They can see because they have the light of this world. But at night, there is a danger of stumbling because they have no light." Verse 11 reads, "Then he said, 'Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I will go and wake him up.'" The disciple says, "Lord, if he is sleeping, he will soon get better." I'll read another verse. They thought Jesus meant Lazarus was simply sleeping, but Jesus meant Lazarus had died. 14, so he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. And for your sakes, I'm glad I wasn't there, for now you will really believe. Come, let's go see him." And down in verse 23, he talks to Martha, and he says in verse 23, "Jesus told her, 'Your brother will rise again.' 'Yes,' Martha said, 'he will rise when everyone else rises at the last day.' Jesus told her, 'I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying.'" Thus far, the reading of the Lord's word. Before you take a seat, turn to your neighbor and help me announce this message today. Say, "Neighbor, what do you know about Jesus?" Now look at somebody else and say, "Neighbor, have you ever gone from failure to fulfillment?" Amen. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. From failure to fulfillment. We sang that song. We chimed that song. That's a call and response. What do you know about Jesus? And y'all say, you know, and I don't know what your "he's all right" is, but we know he's all right. He will work it out. He is our Lord. He's our Savior. There's nothing that he can't do. I remember this passage of scripture. The first time I remember it was a kid. We had seven kids in the family. That's only half of the lead table. But here, seven kids in the family. And on Sunday, you know, we had your service and then you went home for Sunday dinner. But one of the things we had to do for Sunday dinner in preparation was, then my dad said, "Y'all make sure y'all have a Bible verse before we say our prayer around the table." Y'all don't know nothing about that, right? So when we were around the table having dinner and they had to have the prayer before the blessing of the food, we all had to have a scripture verse. Anybody remember them days? We had to have a scripture verse. So my dad said, "Y'all better come back with a new verse today." And so we all in the back, and we all in the back room. We call it the TV room. We're back there, and we have Bibles, all the Bibles, and everybody's looking through a verse. And you know, everybody was fighting for that one verse, John 11:36. Two words: Jesus wept. And he's like, "You better not come back with Jesus wept. You better say a whole new scripture." So out of seven kids, you wanted to be the one to capture that verse. So that was my verse that one Sunday. After that, I had to go through the rest of the Bible and find some Proverbs or something like that. And so in this passage, we see this story, this familiar passage of Lazarus. Lazarus, who was sick unto death. And of course, this is Jesus, who's been going through town to town healing people, healing the sick, raising the dead, blind are able to see, the lame are able to walk. All these miracles are going on. And here they say, "Your friend is dying." Then Jesus, with all that, you know, when you hear about someone in your family, if they're sick, the first thing you do is try to find a plane ticket or a car or something to get where they are. And what does the passage read? And Jesus waited two more days. When your answer is delayed, when your answer seems to be denied, there are things that we see here. In other words, here is this individual. Here is this person, Lazarus. He is sick and he dies. And dying is a form of failure, right? You know, your heart failed. Everything that was working no longer works. So here's this sense of failure. Many people's eyes, they're probably thinking, well, Jesus, you healed everybody. How did you let him die? So, you know, the thought was, well, maybe, well, okay, he's going to rise again when everybody else rises. He's like, you don't understand what I'm saying. You don't understand who I am. I am the resurrection and the life. I'm telling you, we're going to go wake him up. He's just sleepy right now. And so here, I want you just to think about a couple of things when you think of this moment in your life. Have you ever had a moment where you faced failure? You ever have a moment where what you thought was going to work, how it was going to work, it didn't work out that way. It didn't happen how you thought. As a matter of fact, you failed. It's hard to say that sometimes. Sometimes we don't want to admit, or it's hard to admit, you know, our failure. It's hard to admit that it's not working. It's hard to admit that I thought it was going to work out, but it did not. It's like taking a test in school. It's like, you know, you studied or you didn't study. Either way, you thought you were going to do better than you did. You thought you were going to get at least double digits. Somebody caught that. You thought you were going to get something higher than what you got. And you failed. You was going for the blue lettering, but the teacher put the red lettering. You know, when you see red, that traumatizes every child. And so there's failure that happened. But I want to just share with you today, and I pray that you get it, that God has a way of taking us from failure to fulfillment. God has a way of working out the things that seem like they don't go right. Romans 8:28, all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to those who are called according to his purpose. So this is how, as we look through this passage, we look through this story, I want you to see, how was it that Jesus said, this is not unto death? How did he get to that place? How did he declare this and walk? And we know the results. We know Lazarus rose from the dead. We know that he called him out of the tomb. How did this happen? Couple of things I think we need to understand. Number one, we got to understand that there's God's timing. Everybody say timing. God has timing. There's a timing in God. We must trust God. We must believe God because there is timing. What about God's timing? God's timing is perfect. Anybody believe that God's timing is perfect? We sang it. We grew up singing it. It may not come when you want him, but he's what? He's right on time. Well, that's what that means. That means that sometimes you're waiting for God to answer. It's an urgent need. It's something urgent, Pastor John. But we know it's God's timing, and his timing is always perfect. His timing is not only perfect. I was with Pastor Joe, and I was helping him out with his watch, and I was looking at the watches, one of them little fancy watches. You got to have the automatic wind and all these things. Well, part of what I needed to do was get the timing right. Not just it's about 3 o'clock. No, that watch was too fancy for just about 3 o'clock. God's timing is not just perfect. His timing is precise. Precise. He knows exactly when he's going to do it and how he's going to do it. Even in a sense of failure, God's timing is precise. There's a precision to what God wants to do. That's why when he told Noah what to do, when he told Noah how to build the ark, there was a certain way Noah had to build the ark. When he was talking to Moses about the temple, there were certain things they had to do. Y'all go read that story. Y'all know what happened when they touched the ark. Y'all know what happened when Aaron's sons were playing around. Y'all saw what happened. There's this precision that God has, which is why we can trust him, why we can walk in confidence no matter what the situation looks like, no matter what has happened, what has taken place. God's timing is perfect, it's precise, it's purposeful. There's a purpose to God's timing. He knows why he let that fail. He knows why you didn't get that answer when you thought you'd get the answer. He knows why it didn't happen the way you thought it was going to happen when you thought it was going to happen. He knows why you may be going through the turmoil that you're going through. But it's God's timing and it's purposeful. There's God's timing, but then there is timing that happens But there's also a turnaround. Everybody say turnaround. Turnaround, turnaround. John 11:11, we read it says, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I will go and wake him up. That's what Jesus said. He's falling asleep, but I'm going to wake him up. So in other words, there's a turnaround. I want you to know that in the turnaround, you might be waiting for something. What are you waiting for? What is your waiting? You might be Lazarus. I know this sounds crazy, but Lazarus was waiting. He was waiting for God's perfect, precise, and purposeful timing. Here he is waiting. He's waiting. There may be some studies. I know Pastor John is all in the Word, and you know maybe do that study. Maybe that was Lazarus waiting in the arms of Abraham. Maybe. He's waiting. He wasn't going to be there for long because something was about to take place. That's another research, another study on another day. But what are you waiting for in this turnaround? There's a turnaround, although we see it says he has fallen asleep. The fact that he said fallen asleep and didn't say die, even though he meant dead, but he meant that it's still this situation, this failure is not permanent. I'm about to turn some things around. You might be waiting. You may be, if you look at the setting, if you look at what happened here, Lazarus, I'm going to skip to the part where here he is out of the grave. We call Lazarus forward. Here he is. He's still bound up in grave clothes. Even though you are coming out of a situation, you ever still felt bound up? You ever still felt like you wasn't as free as you thought you would be? Here he is wound up in his grave clothes, like a mummy. Jesus said, loose him and let him go. There's some things, even though you feel constricted, when the time comes and you need to be set loose, there's a time that comes, and you got to understand there's some things that might be holding you back. So look at your neighbor and say, what's holding you back? I didn't say who's holding you back. What's holding you back. We can blame folks all the time, but you got to ask the question, what's holding you back? What is it that you need to be free from? What is it that you need to be loosed of? There's a turnaround that God has. But I thank God that in this turnaround, in this season of what might seem to be failure, there's a waiting. There is something where we are allowed to be free. Understand also that nothing has been wasted. Y'all know the story. If you read the story, remember it said that he came out and let me just say this way, he didn't smell like death. 3 days, there should have been some stinking flesh. There's something should have wasted away. I want you to know that whatever you have been going through, whatever you've been waiting for God to do, when God has purpose with you in mind, nothing can stop it. The time that has passed, it doesn't matter what has passed. God still will preserve and restore anything you thought you lost. Let me just give you a word. Don't try to fix it or make up for what you think you lost. Stop trying to make up for what you think you lost. What God has, whatever you got rid of, God has better. Do I have a witness in this building? God always has better for whatever we let go of. God always has better for whatever we have to get rid of. God will restore. God will help you. God will sustain you. He'll sustain you and he'll help you in terms of whatever you're going through. So I want you to understand that nothing has been wasted. The time spent has not been wasted. I got to say it one more time because sometimes we think, you know, we get bitter, we get angry, we say, Lord, if I just would have did this, if I just would have shifted, but understand God is saying that the time is spent, nothing has been wasted. Come here, Israelites, they walked through the wilderness, they walked through the valley 40 years, and what did the Bible say? Their shoes weren't even worn out. I don't know what kind of Nikes those were, but I'm just telling you right now, God has a way of sustaining us and preserving us and keeping us. And whatever the enemy meant for evil, God still turns it around for good. Somebody say turn around. There's a turnaround. There's timing. Hallelujah. There's a timing that God has. We might be waiting, wound up, nothing's wasted. But I like this part. There's also a testimony. Somebody say, I got a testimony. Listen, the power of your testimony will be reflected differently than you thought. This time, it's going to be a little different. I know we know about the testimony. We know about the testimony of the saints. We know that the word of our testimony of how we got saved, we know that that defeats the enemy. But I want to tell you something about this testimony. We know the story. I wasn't going to focus so much on him calling Lazarus and, you know, if he'd have called or any other name, everybody out of the grave. We're not going to go with that. Y'all know that. Y'all got that preach. Somebody else going to come in, preach and tear it up. But I just want to tell you something today that I believe that God wants you to hear something about your testimony. Your testimony might be a dangerous thing for your life. We're going to look at it for a second. There's a passage of scripture here. We see it here. When you move down, it says right there in John chapter 12, verse 9-11, it says, when all the people heard of Jesus' arrival, they flocked to see him and also to see Lazarus, the man Jesus had raised from the dead. Here it goes. The leading priest decided to kill him. They wanted to kill him too because it was because of him that many people had deserted and believed in Jesus. They were upset that because Lazarus was healed and came back from the dead, now you just changed our plan. You changed our agenda. They couldn't celebrate the fact that he was living. They had the nerve to get upset to where they wanted to take him out. Just think about it. Just think about what's going on. Look at this. See, he showed up alive. They wanted to kill him because he showed up alive. Ain't that, you ever have anybody in your life who they kind of seem like they just a little taken back that you still standing after all the hell you've gone through? That you still smiling after what has happened, how people mistreated you, how you went through this situation, you went through that situation, and you're still standing, and in the words of Pastor John, you still smiling? So here, he shows up, and they're looking at Jesus, but now they're looking at him. And now they're plotting to kill him. They want to take him out. There he is, standing up there, risen from the dead. You see, y'all gotta know how to read the Bible. Yeah, just picture that setting. Here's Jesus. The crowd's going to get healed. Here's a testimony of his power to heal and raise the dead. And they're looking at him with their arms folded. I bet you think you something. Got out the grave. Why don't you just stay dead? Well, I know that's just back then. That stuff don't happen now. But I just want you to see the power of your testimony will be reflected. Understand Lazarus, his life, his living, his showing up alive, it helped him. Just showing up alive spoke more volumes than anything else. Amen. Sometimes we talk too much. Yeah. I'm saying that for a reason. I'm saying I'm taking a different turn and different direction on this testimony. I'm not talking about testimony when you say first giving honor to God, the head of my life, past prayer. You know, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the testimony of you just standing. I'm saying the testimony of you just holding your head up and moving forward. Your testimony that I may not be what they are. I may not be what this person is, but I'm not who I used to be. I may not be perfect, but I know that God has a plan for my life. I know God worked out some things. Sometimes let your progress speak for you. Sometimes you don't have to tweet it. You don't have to text it. You just need to show up. You just need to get up. You need to just hold your head up. In other words, your enemy should not have a copy of your screenplay. You don't need to give the enemy the blueprints of how you got to where you got. You just need to show up and say, God did it. They will see soon enough what God has manifested in your life. Hope somebody's getting something out of this. You understand your testimony. Here he is, showed up. And just to show up, I can't help but to say it again. Just the part, he's just standing there and they hated on the brother. He's just there. But his life, so many people believed because of that. So many people believed in Christ because of that. So many people's lives were turned around because of the testimony of this life. I know they talk about it now, but this was existing well before the internet. This was an influencer. This was one. Here he is, influenced the world because of what Jesus did. Your testimony, there's a testimony, but listen, your testimony might be targeted. Your enemies recognize it. They recognize that your testimony makes you a target. But the same God who raised you is the same God who will keep you and cover you. Do I have a witness in here? The Bible says in Isaiah 26, 3, it says, God will keep you in perfect peace, all who trust in you, all whose thoughts are fixed on you. Can I say, God, keep me in perfect peace. God will keep you in perfect peace, even when you are targeted. Here he is standing there, and I'm sure he was glad to be alive once more and again. Targeted, this testimony, you're targeted, but the testimony is influenced, as I said before. In other words, you survived it. Actually, you failed, but you recovered. Come on, stop focusing on the failure and start thinking about the recovery. Do I have a witness in here? Stop focusing on the things that didn't work out, but as that cup says, as a cup my wife, we got for some people at co-workers, and one of the cups talked about that serenity prayer. God grant me the serenity. In other words, I know things weren't always like they should be. I know that I failed a few times and a few more times, but God, I want to focus on the peace that you give me right now. Right now. I was thinking about that. We were driving here, and you know, I was just, for some reason, I was telling my wife, for some reason, on Forensic Files, they was talking about different cases and murder cases and all. Well, of all nights, they decided to talk about Chattanooga, Tennessee, and that big whiteout that they had where it was a 100-car pileup. And so as we're driving here today, all I saw was nothing but white. Y'all might not see here, but it was, I couldn't see the road except for what was right in front of me. And I'm saying that to say, I said, well, Lord, why? What, are we going the right direction? What is going on? Why can't I see anything? And I'm just thinking about this big car pileup and this accident. But then the Lord started just give me a little message in that and started reminding me that sometimes when you can't see nothing else around you, you focus on right what's ahead of you. I'm a present help. He told Martha, you talking about the resurrection, and the resurrection is standing right in front of you. The help that you need is standing right in front of you. And God wants someone to know today that no matter what you're going through, understand you survived stuff before. You survived bad times before. You survived when you couldn't make it before. So why don't you focus on what's ahead of you right now? The Bible says, don't worry about tomorrow. Today has enough trouble. Focus on today. Focus on right now. Focus on the one who's the beginning and the end, the author and finisher of your faith. You survived it. You recover. Not because of anything you did, but what God did helped you recover. Your testimony might be targeted. Your testimony will be your influence because you survived. Your testimony will be an impact because others believe. They saw you come back on the scene. They saw you get back up. Someone's watching your life. Yeah. You may have failed. You may have fallen. You may have made mistakes, but they're watching to see if you're going to get back up. They're watching to see if you're going to hold your head up. They're watching to see, do you really trust that God is who he says he is? Your life will impact others. Your testimony is an impact for others. Later on, this was what we just read was that was the later on. Here he is, came out the tomb, came out the grave. People witnessed it. They all knew who he was. They knew he was sick. So to see him recover was a testimony in and of itself. So how do I walk in fulfillment? I'm glad you ask. Number one, this is what I want you to just to take what you have. No fear in going back where you failed or where you were rejected. Now, I know when you hear the word back, you start thinking, well, I'm not going back. I'm moving forward. We're moving forward. I understand that. But remember they told Jesus, they said, Jesus, you're going to go where they wanted to kill you? You're going to go back there? Jesus understood there was a bigger purpose and bigger plan than what man had. What fear mongers tried to get you to be afraid of. Don't have fear. Now you realize the reason you need to be there. Sometimes it takes failure to get you to realize what the real purpose was. Sometimes we go on stuff with our own purpose in mind, but God has a way of shaking those things loose. And you begin to see clearly. You may have been held up. You may have, where Jesus says he waited two more days. So it might seem like a holdup to what the provisions or the plan that God has for you. But understand, don't have fear, because God is working it out. Have a vision in mind. And go in God's promise. In other words, declare it, decree it. Speak contrary to the situation. He said, our friend Lazarus is falling asleep, and I'm just going to go wake him up. Sometimes you got to speak like that to your situation. Things didn't work out, but I'm going to go and make this phone call and get this job again. Things aren't, you know, money might be funny, but I'm going to go and make this phone call and go ahead and put down a down payment on the house. I'm just saying, sometimes you got to talk like that. Go in God's promise. What did God say? I know what the situation says. I know what it looks like. But what did God say? He's a present help in the time of trouble. Do I have a witness in here? Have no fear going back. Watch the people who you are following. Watch the people who are following your progress. This is the caution, by the way. Because some of them may actually be upset because of your progress. I said they were watching him. And instead of celebrating, they wanted to take him out. So, in other words, when you go back, be bold, but also watch God break every barrier that's in your way. Watch God break the barriers. Watch him break the barriers. And we walk in fulfillment because our deliverance will be reflected. It will be reflected in how you respond. What's your response going to be to what God's promises for your life? How do you respond? How do you respond? Think about it. He said, Lazarus, come forth. What if Lazarus said, I don't want to come out? I mean, we never asked that question, but you know, God doesn't make us do anything. He said, well, Lord, you know, kind of okay in this bound up situation. Kind of like this darkness. Kind of like being shut in. Kind of like being isolated. But I think when Lazarus heard his name, he said, that's all I've been waiting for. Some of y'all have been waiting for something for a little while now. And I dare you to just sit back long enough and hear God call your name. He knows your name. He knows my name. And when he calls your name, you better start walking forward. You can't walk. You might be bound a little bit, but I'm sure Lazarus came out like this. He might have been walking. When I was growing up, we watched Scooby-Doo, and they always had that mummy, and the mummy was walking like that. But then there was this part where, you know, what happened was, that's why I said it, sometimes it's the turnaround. You know, I always like the part where they grab the mummy by the end of the cloth, and they start pulling, and when they pulled it, the mummy turned around. And God is saying, I'm turning some things around. I got to unwind you so I can turn you around. And when I turn you around, I'm going to reveal who you really are. I'm going to reveal the plan I have for you. God said, I want to reveal some things, but you got to trust me to, when I call your name, that you'll come forward. How do you respond? How are you smelling? Do you smell like you believe? He'll smell like there's been a change. They said he didn't smell like he was dead for 3 days. God is saying, when I keep you, when I preserve you, you will not be affected by the things that will attack you. You will not be affected by the things that are around you. I remember when I had COVID in December last year, when I was still standing because God kept me in the things that happen around you. Don't take it for granted that God is keeping you. Don't take it for granted that God still has a plan for you. Your life. How are you smelling? How are you responding? Then if you're going to walk in fulfillment, what are you wearing? Because what you got on now, God has some new clothes for you. God has a new outfit for you. God has a change for you. All these things had to line up. Turn to somebody and say, you got to change your grave clothes. Because you're not in the grave no more. You're not in the place where you are bound. You're not in the place where it's dark. But God has a change on your life.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Songwriter said, it won't always be like this. Because God will perfect that concerning me. Sooner or later, it'll turn in my favor. It's turning around for me. Somebody declare that today. I dare you to declare that today, that it's turning around. It's turning around. It's turning around. He's turning it around. Come on, he's making a change. I know what it looks like. I know what they said. But no, God, when he says it, that's what he means. If he says, I'm bringing you up, if he says, I'm going to take you out of that, he means that. Sometimes folks in all their good intentions are saying, well, maybe what? No, that's not what he told me. So make sure you know what God has told you. Make sure you know what you hear God saying, and then walk in that purpose. Walk in that fulfillment, because God will turn it around. He'll reveal his plan for you. He will show you who you are. Lazarus now was on this global tour or this little nation tour. However far it was that he traveled with Jesus. And like, that was the one. Matter of fact, remember they had the celebration at the house. Because here he is. He was dead, but now he's alive. I once was blind, but now I see. Could you just imagine that setting? Could you imagine the celebration? Could you imagine? We're in a time now where people are dying, where people are failing right where they are and giving up hope. I said before, your testimony can be that influence. Not your testimony of your tongue, but sometimes your testimony of just being there. Just holding your head up. Just showing up. God wants to do great things in our lives. But we must walk from failure to fulfillment. And we can only do that by trusting him. And trusting in him. If you believe that, I just dare you right now, right where you are, give God a praise in this place. Come on, begin to declare that. Come on, begin to just walk in that. You know what God has for you. You know the plans he has for you. And if you don't know the plans, I dare you just to hold on a little bit longer. Just trust in him. God will reveal it. He'll make it plain. He'll make it clear. We got to learn how to trust him. It gets hard. Failure is a hard thing. And if you don't believe it, keep living. You experience failure. It seemed like there's no way up, no way out. When anybody ever know or have ever worked out once upon a time or even studied it, in exercise and in physical fitness, when you work on weights, you work your weights to failure. And you really don't go beyond that because then you really get injured. But when you work to failure, what happens? You start growing. Brother in the back, You work out, I know. But it took some failure for anything to start growing. I see little kids, I work with kids, I do STEM and teach engineering and things like that to little kids, and their parents come pick them up. One parent came and she was tall as me. And I said, now I know he's small right now. This, you about to get a 7-footer. You better start investing in them now. You don't see it now. But that failure works on the inside. Let God take your failure and watch him grow your life into the purpose that he wants it to be. Are you willing to trust him? Can you trust him a little bit longer? I know it delayed, but you know, we say, but delay is not denied. He's like, I have a precise timing. I'm coming to show up. I want to help you. I know what's going on. I know what happened. But begin to declare and decree in me that no matter what you go through, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Nothing that is planned by the enemy will take God by surprise, because he has a greater plan for you. What do you know about Jesus? He's still all right. Come on, somebody. I want you just to let that hit. Let that hit. I don't know a lot about a lot of other things, but one thing I know about Jesus, that he's all right, that he'll make a way, that he'll come through on time. What I know about Jesus is that when everybody else walked away, he was right there. When I failed him, he was right there. When I denied him, he was right there. He's interceding for us right now. Bible says we don't pray as we ought, but the Spirit intercedes with moanings and groanings that cannot be uttered. God sees us. He sees the blood. You have the blood of Christ over your life. He's our source. And he has a plan. And I know he's going to work it out. Father, I thank you even right now for the hearers. And Lord, I just speak over their lives even now. I decree and declare that the best is yet to be. We thank you, God, for your plan. Thank you for your love. Thank you, Lord, that you are turning some things around for us. I even believe that you're turning around whatever it is we decide to surrender to you. God, we receive that word right now, that someone needs to just surrender everything to you so you can turn it around. God, we give you our future because you own the future. We give you our lives. God, we are bought with a price. We thank you, Jesus. We declare right now in the name of Jesus that we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. God, we pray, God, even right now, God, that those who do not know you, God, begin to work with their hearts even right now. Let them know. Don't let them, if they hear my voice, Lord, let them not walk into a new year. If you delay your return without knowing you, without accepting Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, without giving you everything, we bless you right now in the name of Jesus. We declare it done. We declare it so. Pastor John, come. Hallelujah. 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 Bless you, brother. Bless you.
Let's give God
the
praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Ah. Exactly what we need.
Hallelujah.
Somebody missed church today. And they missed what their soul needed.
Mm.
They can get some food and some gifts, but they need their soul.
Yes.
Amen. I thank God for his word and his promises. He told Israel in the time of failure, I know the plans that I have.
Yes.
The plans
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Ah.
Hallelujah. Abba Shata Kodo Shapa. Ababa Shatoko. Miruru Shipipi. Ababa Shatoko. Ibaba Shah Dapapoko. Edede Shikodoka. Edede. Hallelujah, God. I bless you for my brother right now. Papa Ko Shede. Thank you, God, for the plan, God. Ibabo Shika. God, for the work of the plan, God. Iroro Shatakata Koko. God, we thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Thank you for your keeping power. Hallelujah, God. It's just your Greek God and the Spirit God. Thank you, Jesus, right now, God. Hallelujah, God. We thank you, Lord. Turned around every situation, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. God bless you, God, for the Lord. Hallelujah, God. We thank you. Hasha. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ababa Shatako. Ababa Shay. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Can I pray for you, brother?
Yeah.
Thank you, God, for my brother, Lord, right now. Bless you, God, for his life, Lord. Thank you, God, for the plan you have, Lord. I just pray, Lord, whatever situations, Lord, as he encounters, Lord, I pray you continue to keep him, Lord. Continue to show him, God, your will, your plan. God, continue, Lord, to move and manifest, Lord, God, great favor over him. I just thank you, Lord, God, for it, Lord. We pray, God, for even the new year, God. It'd be, God, things that he did not expect, Lord, in a great way, in a good way. God, continue, Lord, to hold him up, Lord. Continue, Lord, to, God, just manifest and give him insight, God. Give him oversight, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord. We bless you, God, for it now, for the great testimony, God, my brother, Lord, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Bless you, brother.
What made you want to pray for me?
I just, you know, just wanted to come around here. Sometimes, you know, we do the altar call. I say, you know, Lord, just.
And that's good. You know, I wanted to. My childhood friend a couple weeks ago, man, stuck a gun on me and robbed me. I went to help him out. He didn't take very much from me, but he robbed me.
Yeah.
I know him all my life.
Wow.
Yeah. I've never been robbed in my life. The man robbed me, and I just want to thank God because I know he was on something. I didn't know it at the time, but I later on found out that he was on something.
Yeah, yeah.
To make him do something this desperate.
Wow.
For so little amount.
Wow.
Actually pulled a gun on me. And I was mad, I was angry, and I went towards him with the gun. And it was just a bad situation, so I just want to thank God because you never know, a situation like that could always turn. Because he pulled the gun.
Wow, wow.
So I just like to thank God for keeping me blessed and safe in that situation.
Amen.
The man pulled the gun.
Man, and that's challenging, God, man. Man, and what's your name, brother?
My name is Michael.
Michael, okay, that's my brother's name. Okay, all right. New York.
My man, the borough, the upstate.
Long Island.
Mm-hmm. My man, are you from the...
We got churches in Brooklyn and Queens and...
What's up? How long
are
you gonna be in town?
Oh, just probably tomorrow or so.
That's wonderful.
Yes,
wonderful.
Sir. Yes, sir.
And that's when you're going back to Long Island?
I'm going back to Long Island, New York. Yes, sir.
What's up? I've been in Brooklyn 159th.
Oh, yeah, man. Nice bless you, man. Same here, brother. Yeah, bless you, brother.
You,
yes,
so
sir. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. You have called me friend. Hallelujah. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me.
Yes, sing that with us this morning before we leave. I am a friend of God, he calls me friend. Do you believe that this morning?
Says,
I am a friend of God. I know I am. I am a friend of God. You are a friend of God, he calls me friend.
thanks for every gift and giver. We pray that you had a wonderful Merry Christmas. Let's stand with us. Let's sing that one more time. Is that okay?
Oh, I'm a friend of God. You are a friend of God.
Yes.
I'm a friend of God.
You better believe that this morning. You got a friend in Jesus.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
God Almighty.
God Almighty. Lord of glory.
Repeat after me, let the words of my mouth and the meditation that's in my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Hug someone, tell them you love them, and God bless you. Thanks again. Touch my heart.
Plan. In fact, we're going to try to get your dad a couple of things. A couple of things he did that before. And as far as eating food, you know, a couple of things. That's what we ask him.
Yeah, I know that's right. Okay, but don't get out of here before we can bless you all. Okay?
Yeah, it was nice. Shit at the time.
Oh, yes, that's right.
Bless the word. That's the word.
Yeah.
Appreciate the word. Yes, Rand. Rand? Okay. You gotta go to work tonight. No, no. I'm gonna go slide in there for a few hours.
We are going to be.